Hello guys, in the last lecture we discussed about diodes. So PN junction diode. So we said that if we join a P-type material and an N-type material, we get what is known as diode. Now we discuss about how this particular PN junction diode forms. And while forming a diode, formation of diode, we say that there is creation of a depletion region between this P-type material and N-type material. So this is a depletion region. And we also said that this depletion region is because of, this is caused by transfer of electron from N-type to P-type material, and this transfer of electron also leads to what is known as formation of barrier potential. So we said that there will be a negative potential on P side and there will be a positive potential on N side. We discussed this in more detail. We are also going to discuss this a little bit in this lecture as well. So this is what we discuss, and then we discuss about the characteristic of diode. And we say that the diode, the symbol of diode is something like this. So this is anode and this is cathode. So when I connect the anode to a positive potential, so anode is basically P-type material and cathode to N-type material, this particular thing is known as forward bias condition. And if we reverse the battery connection, so the anode is connected to a negative potential and cathode is connected to a positive potential, this is known as reverse bias condition. Okay, so the characteristic of the diode, when we talk about characteristic of electronic circuit, we talk about IV characteristic. So on the x-axis we have voltage and the y-axis we have current, and we say that during a forward bias, so in forward bias the voltage, applied voltage is positive, and in reverse bias the applied voltage is negative. This will be reverse bias. So the characteristic would look something like this. Up to one particular voltage, the current is zero and it suddenly increases. Something like this. And in reverse bias, the current will remain small and then it suddenly shoots up. So on this direction the current is measured in microampere, and over here on positive side the current is measured in milliampere. And if I extrapolate the point over here, this is my barrier potential, and this particular point is known as breakdown voltage. So we discuss about why this breakdown takes place, and this breakdown takes place because of avalanche breakdown. This is called as avalanche breakdown. We discussed that in the last lecture in more detail. And this is the potential. This barrier potential is the potential above which the diode starts conducting. For silicon, if I have silicon dioxide, this potential is 0.7 volt. For germanium, the potential is 0.3 volt. Please note, this is barrier potential. This has nothing to do with the band gap of the material. The band gap of, let's say, silicon is 1.1 electron volt. This is a potential, not energy, voltage, right? And for germanium, the band gap is around 5.9, so around 6 electron volt. So these are the band gap of germanium and silicon. This is the barrier potential over here. This is the barrier potential. Okay, so what does that particular thing means? This barrier potential means, it means that the diode, if it is made up of silicon, if this diode is made up of silicon, this is PN junction diode, let's say, and if this is made up of silicon, and if I connect a battery across it in a forward bias condition, then this diode will conduct current if and only if the applied voltage is greater than or equal to 0.7 volt. Correct, 0.7 volt, if it is made up of silicon. And if it is made up of germanium, it will conduct if and only if applied voltage is greater than 0.3 volt. Now, if you can carefully see over here, a huge amount of current is conducted after the potential reaches this particular value of barrier potential. Below that barrier potential, you can say that the diode is off condition. In a reverse bias condition, a very small amount of current flows, and this small amount of current is because of minority charge carriers. And this forward current is because of majority charge carriers. So we discussed that in more detail. We say that when a PN junction diode is formed, there is creation of depletion region. In today's lecture, we are going to look at what is going to happen to this depletion region when, first thing, doping concentration is changed. And when, second thing, the diode is connected in forward or reverse bias condition. So we are going to look at the effect of doping concentration and biasing on this depletion region. In order to understand the effect of doping concentration and forward and reverse bias on depletion region, we first understand how depletion region is formed. We have discussed it in more detail, but let's, for the sake of completeness, let's discuss it one more time. So this P and N junction, I can describe it something like this. So this is silicon atom which is connected to four neighboring atoms. So since it is a p-type material, the circuit will be something like this. The atomic structure will be something like this. So this is a p-type material, structure of p-type material, and over here there will be a continuation. So these are all interconnected, something like this. And here will be a n-type material. So this is a n-type material, and over here there will be a junction. So this is a junction formed between this p-type and n-type material. So now, as you can see, these are the impurity atoms. So there will be an extra electron over here, extra electron over here, extra electron over here, and in the p-type material there will be a hole over here. Now please note that we have not connected any batteries yet, so no external connection. So this is when we have a intrinsic semiconductor chip. So this is intrinsic semiconductor, and on this side I have doped it with p-type impurity, and on this side I have doped it with n-type impurity. This will be the picture over here, whatever I have shown. Now what's going to happen? Since there are large numbers of electrons on this side and large numbers of holes on this side, in order to have an equilibrium situation, these electrons will try to distribute uniformly throughout this material, because this is a single material. This whole material is a single material. So what's going to happen? This electron will go over here and it will be captured by this hole. This will be captured by this hole. And in the process, since initially this phosphorus atom was neutral and I am now removing an electron from it, it will develop a positive charge. And since I am adding an electron to this boron atom, it will develop a negative charge. Right? Now when the electron from the next phosphorus atom is trying to move across the junction, it will see the potential. This positive charge will try to repel this electron, and this positive charge will try to attract this electron, and this negative charge on the boron will try to repel this electron. But if the energy is sufficient, this electron can also go on this particular side, and again over here I'm going to have a negative ion, and over here I will have a positive ion. And this process will go on and so forth. After each transfer of electron, the electron in n-type material will find it very difficult to cross the junction because of this negative charge developed here over here. So this negative charge will be developing a negative potential, right? So after some time, let's suppose when this is the last electron that gets transferred, so there will be a negative charge developed, there will be a positive charge developed. Now the energy of next electron will not be sufficient to cross this barrier or this particular junction. Now what's going to happen? So if you can see, there are no free charges left over here. Initially there was a free hole over here, there was a free electron over here, there was a free hole over here, there was a free electron over here, there was a free hole over here, and there was a free electron over here. Now there are just immobilized ion. This is a negative ion, negative ion, negative ion. There will be positive ion, positive ion, positive ion. Right? So we have got a region without any free charges from this point to this point. This particular region without a free charge, free electrons, and immobilized ion is our depletion region. So this is depletion region. From here to here, this is a depletion region, right? Now what will happen if I increase this doping concentration? What I mean by increasing doping concentration, when I increase this number of dopant ion, concentration of this dopant ion, now from here to here there was 3 ions. What will happen if the number of ions is 6? And for the sake of completeness, we are going to consider that this equilibrium condition, that no electron can transfer from n-type to p-type material, occurs when 3 electron transferred. We are going to consider this. This is not the case. Consider only 3 electron when transferred from n-type to p-type material, there will be a barrier formation. And now please note, these negative ions is going to develop a potential. So we are going to show that potential over here, negative potential, and this positive ions is going to develop some potential, and that potential we are going to show over here. This is positive potential, and because of this negative and positive charge, whatever potential difference is created, this is known as barrier potential. We discussed this in last lecture, and we are going to consider that only after transfer of 3 electrons this barrier potential is generated. Now this barrier potential will not allow electron to transfer in this direction, since this negative potential is larger than the energy, because of this negative potential is larger than the kinetic energy of this electron, if you like to say something like that. Now what is going to happen when I increase the doping concentration? So in order to increase the doping concentration, what I need to do, I need to replace this silicon atoms by more numbers of boron and phosphorus atom. So the situation will be something like this: boron atom over here, boron atom over here, boron atom over here, phosphorus over here, phosphorus over here, phosphorus over here. Now as you can see, as compared to this particular case, the number of dopant is large over here. This is the representation. So what I have is something like this. I have an electron over here, I have an electron over extra electron over here, I have 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 extra hole over here, hole, there will be a, let's say, silicon atom. Now, and we are going to consider that only 3 electrons will create a barrier potential. Now, when this electron tries to move in p-type region, it will find a boron atom over here or a hole over here, and hence we are going to get a negative charge over here and a positive charge over here. The next electron, the second electron, will find a boron atom over here itself, and hence we are going to get a negative potential over here, developed over here, and a positive potential developed here. And the next is going from this phosphorus atom, and it will recombine with this boron atom. So a positive negative potential over here and a positive ion over here, and then there will be a development of barrier potential, and we are going to get this much amount of depletion region. Now look at these two pictures. This picture is when there is low doping concentration, and this picture is when there is high doping concentration. What do you see over here? Which depletion region, width of depletion region is large? Kaunsi depletion region ka width jyada hai? Low doping ka ya high doping concentration ka? Low doping concentration ka ya high doping concentration ka? Kiska depletion region ka width jyada hai? This width and this width. Kaunsa jyada hai? Which one is larger? Obviously, the low doping concentration will have a larger depletion region width, and high doping concentration will have a low depletion region width. So let me write that over here. So can you see this picture? Okay, so let me write that over here only. So when I have low doping concentration, then depletion width will be large, and when I have high doping concentration, then depletion region width will be small. So in other word, we can say higher the depletion, higher the doping concentration, lower will be the depletion region width. Did you get this particular point? Right? So this is because the same number of electron transferred from n-type to p-type region is creating the barrier potential in this particular case and in this particular case as well. In low doping concentration case, the number of electron spanning transferred from n-type region to p-type region, jitne region se wo transfer hue hai wo jyada rahega because the doping concentration is low. And high doping concentration, the number of electron transfer from n-type region to p-type region, same amount of electrons is going to transfer and barrier potential is creating, but the amount of region from which these electrons are transferred will be small, right? And that's why for high doping concentration, if the doping concentration is higher, the depletion region width will be lower. Now what is going to happen if I have something like this? Suppose this is a p-n junction and I have a very high doping in p region and a high doping in n region. What will happen to the depletion region width? Kaisa rahega, jyada rahega ya kam rahega? The depletion region width will be low. Okay, and let's again consider that if the doping concentration on this side is NH and the doping concentration on this side is NE, and we have the same amount of doping concentration dono jagah pe, itna doping is side mein kiya hai, concentration hai utna hi doping concentration type mein. So depletion region ka width in p type, so let me call it as WP is the depletion region width in P type and depletion region width in N type. What will be the relation between them? It will be same, equal. And what's going to happen if I have something like this? This is a PN junction. This is a P type. This is a N type. Yahan pe mera high doping concentration hai. और यहाँ पे मेरा लो डोपिंग कॉन्सेंट्रेशन है. सो बेसिकली व्हाट आई एम ट्राइंग टू से, द डोपिंग कॉन्सेंट्रेशन इन पी टाइप इज ग्रेटर देन द डोपिंग कॉन्सेंट्रेशन ऑफ एन टाइप. व्हाट इज गोइंग टू हैपन टू विड्थ ऑफ डिप्लीशन रीजन इन पी टाइप एंड विड्थ ऑफ डिप्लीशन रीजन इन एन टाइप? किसमें ज़्यादा रहे डोपिंग कॉन्सेंट्रेशन? इन पी टाइप द डोपिंग कॉन्सेंट्रेशन इज लार्ज. सो व्हाट विल हैपन टू द डिप्लीशन रीजन विड्थ इन पी टाइप? विल बी लोअर. And इसमें कम है डोपिंग कॉन्सेंट्रेशन इन एन टाइप, सो वट विल हैपन टू द डिप्लीशन रीजन विथ? इट विल बी लार्जर. सो ओवर हियर इट विल बी समथिंग लाइक दिस. एंड अगेन वट गोइंग टू हैपन वेन वी हैव समथिंग लाइक दिस? this is p-type, this is n-type, and here I have low doping in p-type region and high doping in n-type material. So doping concentration in p-type is less than doping concentration in n-type. What is the relation between the width of doping depletion region in p-type and n-type? Isme jyada rahega depletion region ka width. Since p-type has a low doping concentration, the depletion region width will be larger. Right? Again, what's going to happen if this is the case? These are the two cases. This is p-type, this is n-type material, and the another case is again a dyad. With p-type material and n-type material. And in the first case, over here, doping concentration in both p and n is low. And over here, doping concentration in p and n is large. Kisme depletion region ka width kam hoga? Let me call it as this is A, case A, and this is case B. For which case the depletion region width will be large, and in which case the depletion region width will be low? So jiska doping concentration jyada hoga, uska depletion region width kam hoga. So over here also we have this particular thing. So do you understand what's going to happen with the doping concentration? With the doping concentration, large doping implies low width depletion region width, and high doping implies low doping implies large depletion region width. And it's not like the doping concentration of p-type and n-type has to be same. No, we can dope one particular material with high doping concentration and another with a low doping concentration, or we can dope both with high doping concentration or both with low doping concentration. It doesn't matter, and depending on that there will be a depletion region width. So if I have to show the depletion regions over here, since it is high doping concentration and in both sides the doping concentration is same, this will be my depletion region. Over here the depletion region will look something like this. In this particular case, the depletion region may look something like this. Look, the width in this side and the width at this side is different. The width at this side and this side is different. Jahan pe low doping concentration hai, wahan pe width zyada hai. Over here, low doping concentration hai dono mein. So yahan pe, and I'm going to consider that ki same doping concentration level hai. So this will be the depletion region. And over here, since the doping concentration is large, this will be the depletion region. Look at this width and this width. Okay, so I can change the depletion region width just by changing the doping concentration. So by changing doping concentration, one can engineer or change depletion condition. So this is the effect of doping concentration on depletion region width. Now let's quickly look at what's going to happen. What is the effect of forward and reverse bias on depletion region width? Biasing on depletion region. So this is my PN junction, and this is, if this is junction, then this will be my depletion region. So I'm going to call it as P-type material. This is N-type material, and this case is forward bias, and there will be a barrier potential over here. Similarly, I could have, this is reverse bias case, so this is forward bias and this is reverse bias. Now what is going to happen to the depletion region? Now as you can see over here, let's consider this particular diagram. Now what we have done, we have connected this to positive potential and this to a negative potential in forward bias condition. Now if you look carefully, this is a positive potential and there is a negative potential developed over here. This positive will try to minimize the effect of this particular charge, and hence the depletion region is going to reduce. Similarly, this negative is going to minimize the effect of this positive charge over here, and the depletion region is going to reduce. So in a forward bias case, because of this forward biasing, the depletion region will reduce. So this is the final depletion region that I'm going to get. So when I forward bias a diode, the depletion region width will reduce. In case of reverse bias, what's going to happen? In case of reverse bias, look over here, for example, I have connected these two negative potential and I have connected this to a positive potential, and since there is a negative potential over here and again negative potential applied, so this will enhance the effect of this negative potential and hence the depletion region will increase. In other words, what I can say is that this hole will be attracted toward this negative potential, and as a result it will leave this ion, and I'm going to get another negative ion created over here. Similarly, this electron will be attracted toward this positive potential, and I'm going to left with a negative ion over here. Sorry, a positive ion over here, because the electron is removed. And hence, the depletion region width will actually increase. You're getting my point. So this positive potential over here will try to attract this particular electron, and hence from these ions, and hence the depletion region width will increase. So in case of reverse bias, when you apply a reverse bias potential, the depletion region width will increase. So in forward bias, the depletion region width reduces. In reverse bias, the depletion region width increases. That's all for today. This is the effect of doping concentration and biasing on depletion region width. Thank you for your time. See you in the next video.